Okay, to those of us who are joining us for the first time, Toastmasters, who is our founder, Dr. Rafsi Smedley, a very kind and very kind gentleman who in the 1930s started this club for the youth in the USA. And who would have known a little club that started out in the basement of YMCA has flourished with an international organization with 100,000s of members. And Toastmasters, being a non-profit organization, is moving and impacting lives. Simply because, as a non-profit organization, you learn how to mobilize people without authority. You learn how to engage lives with simplicity. And as we resume back the next session, I take pride in also introducing a past president, also a very dear friend, who, at just one simple call, told me, okay, madam, he says he will come here not just to give an educational talk, but sometimes there's a dichotomy, right? We think of Toastmasters as time here to just talk. But a lot of us here, I think most of us here are in the workforce. We need to be reminded that whatever that goes out here are perfect skills and tools that must be employed for us to be better in our game. In the next 15 minutes, you'll be experiencing heartfelt sharing from a very experienced Toastmaster. Toastmaster who has also won many contests, even up to the division level. Please help me to introduce my friend and yours, distinguished Toastmaster G. Sivalingam, on this topic, which you'll introduce in a while's time.
Yes.
Can we clap? Thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
Good evening.
Are you all with me? Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you. You all fell asleep with a few minutes. This is an unplanned, not a normal session. I'm going to talk a little bit. This is from your generation, somebody with this generation. A lot of people complain, why Toastmasters? Why should I waste my time here? I know some of you all are here encouraged by your bosses. I'm not sure how far that voluntary part goes of your train to Toastmasters. There are a lot of people, what I'm going to talk about is the second part of Toastmasters today, the relevance of Toastmasters. Everybody knows, I want to become a better speaker. That's why I joined Toastmasters too. Most of us who joined Toastmasters are coming here because better speaker. That's why your bosses most likely did it. And there is a value to this, and I don't deny it. But there is also value in the other part of Toastmasters. Let's say Toastmasters, we don't talk about communication, we talk about a communication and leadership program. And I'd like to talk a little bit about that for these 15 minutes because that is actually directly related to your workplace. It is directly related to your bread and butter. Yes, all of you know, I can speak back there in my meetings, all yes. But the other part is sometimes not quite obvious even to long-time Toastmasters. Let me take a step backwards first. We are all social beings. Human beings are socials. When you say, I am a rebel, fine. But the moment you say you are a rebel, you are a rebel with respect to something else, the majority. If everybody is wearing white clothes and zealing desires, I want to wear black and protest, is a rebel with respect to the rest of society. You cannot be a rebel without being part of a society. Similarly, a heretic, somebody who preaches a different part of religion, is defined with respect to that religion. We are part of society, whether we are in Toastmasters, in our daily, in our family, our neighborhoods, or our working place, we are social beings. We have to talk and react with people. And this is where the Toastmasters program actually does help you directly in your workplace. Let's take a step. It covers you things like project management. I'm not going to cover all, but project management is one. Leadership and persuasion. I'm going to cover these three areas. What do you mean by project management, ladies and gentlemen? What does Toastmasters have to do with project management? All of y'all are working in companies. You have projects going on in your companies. Am I correct? The wolves of people, you have projects all the time. Am I correct? Yes. Software companies are famous for this, isn't it? You have projects going on at a definite beginning and a definite end. And you got problems in your project management, isn't it? Not just, I remember because I was in IT for 7 years, I know. But almost everywhere there are projects, am I correct? And projects go wrong, don't they? And the biggest problem in projects is managing the people. That is why the successful project managers are not necessarily the most technically savvy managers, are they? I remember one of my most capable project managers when I worked in Ericsson, my boss, he was an extremely good project manager in an IT project, but his background was auditing. And yet, he was a super project manager because his people skills were good. How does Toastmasters help you here? When you join a club and you take up, there are events being held. Later, somebody's going to talk about a speech craft program, which is a 2-day program conducted by Toastmasters. The person who took the charge of the thing, a facilitator, Jack, where are you, Jack? Raise your hand. He is actually taking up the role of a project manager. Seriously. Because why? The event is going to be held in 2 months' time, end of April. He has to mobilize a team of people. He has to get the venue. He has to get the people, recruit the customers. He has to organize the food. He has to organize the event. And about, he needs about 10 people per day to run that event. And these are all volunteers. It's project management. It is not formally called project management, but it is a project in every sense of the word. And best of all, you cannot, in the workplace, you have the power of money. You don't pay, you don't do the job, you don't get the increment, or you get fired. Jack does not have that luxury because it's a volunteer organization. All he can do is persuade them, work, hone his social skills. He is actually practicing project management. The beautiful part is, we don't want it to fail. There are projects, but in Toastmasters, if the thing doesn't work out so well, you're not dead. You don't get put in cold storage. People who fail in the corporate environment, especially large organizations, you get put in cold storage. Well, I've heard that term, isn't it? Large companies love that idea. You don't succeed in that project, or you screw up one way or the other, they put you aside and you can sit there forever with no increment, no promotion, until either you resign or you can sit there, you're thick skin enough, you sit there and you die, you retire. So, where are you going to learn? If you take a risk in your workplace, it works out fine. If it doesn't work out, what are you going to do? There's no coming back, there's no forgiveness, right? So what do? You learn in a safe environment. Not just Toastmasters, it could be any society, it could be Lions, it could be Kiwanis, Rotary. But Toastmasters is unique among all these other societies and NGOs because the others are about service. It doesn't matter whether you go to Kiwanis, Rotary, Lions, Switchy, the Sai Baba movement, they are about service. Toastmasters is unique. Toastmasters is about learning to become a better person and a leader, and then you go back and contribute wherever you choose to be. It could be your workplace, it could be your community, I don't know, we don't know, but we are focused on making you a better speaker, that's obvious, but the other part is not so obvious, that's a hidden treasure, so to speak. That's something I discovered over 15 years of Toastmasters. I don't ask you to join to the level of the district, and you talk about that is project management. Same thing for leadership also you learn. The leadership, the presidency is also leadership. 1 year is a time limit. You can be a good president, you can be a lousy president, you can be a so-so president, it doesn't matter, nothing's going to happen to you. And that's the beauty of Toastmasters. When you go to work, people always select the one who's most likely to succeed in this project, isn't it? You are not going to select somebody, let's give this guy a chance to get that $50 million project. That's not going to happen. They are not going to take that kind of risk in a corporate environment. So where are you going to get your break? They always, the most experienced person gets a job, isn't it? When you're going to hire the person to do this high profile project, who's the best leader? Alan. Let's put Alan. He did 3 projects like this, $50 million. Well, what about Jack? He wants to learn, but he's got no track record. Never mind. It's always the message. Because the project cannot afford to fail, everybody protects themselves. But in Toastmasters, we break that chain. The successful become more successful in workplace. You've seen it, right? You do one good job, you get another good one, and you go up. It happens. And that's the nature of life in a corporate environment, big company or small company. So where are you going to learn your skills? Toastmasters. Here, you're not sure of leadership. For myself personally, for me, a turning point came when I was asked to join the club. I was in Mexico. I still remember, after I went to the washroom, I came back, I walked in. Siva, you want to be a speech craft coordinator? Okay. I didn't know what I was saying okay to, but I agreed. But it is a great boost. I ask people and I learn and I'm successful. I made $2,300 for the club and I was like, whoa! First time in my life I made money. It is a great morale booster, ladies and gentlemen. It may be nothing to you. Some of you are dealing in millions and thousands. But for me at that moment, it is a fantastic morale booster. Why, I can do it. Whoa! It's, don't denigrate it. At least it's a safe environment. If I fail, it made 1,000. Okay, what's the big deal? They're not going to come back, hunt me down and kill me now. I don't know what dealing will do though. Hard to say. So Jack, don't take things too easy. Eh? So that's the thing. So it's a chance to practice real world skill. Project manager one, leadership. You're president for one term. And there's something really important in Toastmasters leadership that working environment you don't provide. Working life, so long as you don't screw up, you stay in that position. You screw up, either you get sacked, or you get frozen in place, or you get disciplined. Toastmasters, every position comes with a built-in time limit. You can only hold it for 1 year. You're president for 1 year, and then that's it. Whether you like it, whether you did a good job, whether you screwed it up, you're gone. The next person takes it. So, you don't have, it's a time limit. And that, by the way, applies to every single position. And those of you all are interested in CEO, some of our club members have dreams of becoming CEO. The district governor, the person who leads Toastmasters, the whole of Peninsula Malaysia, all the 300 clubs, that is actually a CEO position. We don't call it a CEO, but it is. The only difference between your company CEO and the Toastmasters district governor is the CEO here doesn't get paid. Not 1 cent. Expenses are covered. But trust me, it is a CEO position in everything but name. When I was the district secretary of the council calculation, the district covered 7 countries in Southeast Asia. And the lady of the district governor, then Ho Fong Meng, she was working as on her own as a consultant. For that 1 year, she put her working career on hold. She was living on credit cards because day and night, emails came in, phone calls came in about Toastmasters across the 7 countries. There were problems falling on her lap, there were serious issues came in. She had to deal with them, and some of them were very serious, some of them involved the police. That's unusual, but it happened. She had to deal with it, wanted something for things. It is like literally a Toastmasters, like a CEO for 1 year without pay. It stretches you to the maximum, but after 1 year, you let go. Not all of you can become BG's CEO, that not necessary. But the club level itself is good enough. The vice president of education, like Jack, is doing. Number two in the club. He is responsible for organizing all the pro meetings for the whole year. Oh, I'm so sorry, Henry too. My apologies. My bad.
Okay, about
this year. Yeah. So I had a senior citizen moment because Jack was supposed to be VP. Never mind. So sorry, Henry.
It's okay.
So this is the thing. Similarly, that's also leadership. It's project management. Henry is supposed to fill up the whole, all the meetings for the year. He's supposed to arrange the speakers, he's supposed to arrange the TME, and if the TME doesn't do the job, he has to fill it. It's just like a managerial job. It's the same thing, you got to persuade people. I'm so tired, I don't want to come last week. I also didn't want to come. Alan called me up and persuaded his golden charms. Come over, I kid. So you learn. You do learn to persuade people to remember the money, dollars are involved. If I don't come, so what? I don't get money, I don't lose money. My bread and butter doesn't come from here. But I learned those skills, ladies and gentlemen, and you learn them, and things go wrong. Will they go wrong? Of course they go wrong. That's when you learn, oh my God, this is not how I should motivate people. Why did the guy no longer talking to me? Because I offended him in public. Oh Lord, at least you don't make the same mistake in your workplace. It's free training. The consequences are not so serious, and it's just 1 year worse than worse. Okay, you serve an exco. What happens? People join a club. They take up a position BPM 1 year, fine. After that, they continue. You can, if not, they step down. That's fine. 1 year you serve and you learn, and the club manages. And the beautiful part, even if you're not perfect, it doesn't matter. The structure, Toastmasters genius, is its structure. This is our 90th anniversary. The structure compensates for all kinds of problems. You have a lousy president, never mind. Lousy VP, never mind. The structure compensates it, the way they organize it. It's unlikely to fail. So the burden is not so heavy on you. The stress is not there. It is not a walk in the park. But you learn those skills with minimal risk, ladies and gentlemen. You try this at work, you make one mistake, you're dead. You can't afford that at workplace. So you learn the skills of dealing with people. That's the power. I told about leadership, I talked about project management, there's one more thing, and that is what is known as, when you look at the role of logistics, ladies and gentlemen, you learn how to organize things. As sergeant at arms, how do you, when something happens, an event takes place, how do you get the food done? The SAA is responsible for arranging the food also is unique, arrange to get the food in, organize the food, get the plates. Don't underestimate the small things, those are values. And let alone, this was a very experienced Toastmaster, a past district governor, a very inspiring man. He spoke once, he's got the working credentials, a director of a semiconductor firm, now he's CEO of another organization. He said, every role in Toastmasters you learn. Your R counter is also important. Later you see the role, listening all the R's and ums and all this. Every single is role, at the very least, in the R counter you take to make a commitment, you learn to make your commitments and follow through. And that's a valuable skill at your workplace also. A lot of people don't follow through at workplace. You learn those skills. You learn about commitment, you learn about being supporting your team members, and those values are directly applicable even in your workforce. So there are direct analogies. The idea is, when you do it in Toastmasters, there's a safety net. You don't destroy your future career. You learn step by step. I don't want to talk about the communication. Everybody knows about it. That's why the CEOs all love their staff to go, but the staff always resist. That happens everywhere. Or they go under duress and they say, yeah, we went, boss. You know, sorry, today, no time. Something, I don't know. Don't come there because your boss forced you or threatened you or whatever. I saw quite a number of people who came from CEO because the boss wanted Anna also, I think. Anne, is it? Yeah, but never mind. But come because there is something in it for you also. That's the thing. Do you have any questions? This is not a monologue, but I just wanted to share a little bit because a lot of people forget about this hidden aspect of Toastmasters, the leadership part. Unfortunately, leadership isn't handed, there's no manual. You have to live the process. But if it's a problem for you, you can't deal with people, people are sabotaging you, you can't get the commitment of people, you're not going to survive. You're not going to go up in the corporate ladder without the soft skills. You need to motivate people. And people are people no matter whether they are paid or they are volunteers. It's the same skills. Yeah. I did require you not to ring the bell, yes, but never mind. So, ladies and gentlemen, are there any last questions? With this, I hope it helped you open up a different aspect of Toastmasters, which is directly relevant to your workplace. Thank you, and back to you, Toastmasters.
Would you say that distinguished Toastmasters G. Sivalingam was passionate about what he was talking about?
Yes.
Without a shadow of doubt. And I think this is the part that we want to have this evening, Hashong.